mighty Desert Eagle. Let's talk about it. Okay, boys and girls, today we're taking a look at the Desert Eagle, and we're actually doing some myth-busting on this infamous gun. Now, admittedly, with this video, I'm not seeking to change anyone's mind or anyone's opinion. The Desert Eagle is a gun that you either love or you hate. You either believe in it or you don't. You know, you think it's a good gun or you think it's complete garbage. There's really not much sense in being able to change an opinion on that regard. However, there are a lot of myths floating around on the internet. I thought today I would break down just a couple of them and kind of explain why this gun is not as bad as some of these myths make it out to seem. So let's jump into it. So let's jump into some of these myths from a popular website that we won't mention. So the first myth to this gun is that it's heavy. Now, I know that this might sound funny, like it's a myth that it's heavy. It is, of course, heavy. This gun is close to 4 pounds. But with this gun, I think it's proper, or that you have to put yourself in the right frame of mind for a Desert Eagle. And that is that this gun is, as far as the bullet goes, 50 AE, is punching above the weight of a 44 Magnum. And so this gun is kind of entering the territory of a Super Magnum handgun calibers, things like 454 Casull. And so when we start to talk about handguns that are in the range of this gun, you know, with its capabilities, with the stopping power, or with the kinetic energy, rather, that this bullet has, you have to understand that every gun in this category is heavy. There aren't a lot of light guns in this kind of category of handgun, or in this realm of handguns. And in fact, really, you don't want these types of handguns to be particularly light, even if you could get them that way, just because the sheer amount of recoil that these handguns produce is a lot. And so you would not want it to be a super light handgun. So that is the first kind of myth, and I think, like I said, when you put this gun into the proper frame of mind, when you think about this gun as a large caliber, kind of a super magnum handgun, it makes a lot more sense. So the second one is that this gun is an automatic. Now, it is true that there is some semblance or some truth to the reliability of this handgun. It is not 100%, but really no gun is 100% either. Now, the argument that this particular person was saying is that, you know, revolvers are more reliable than semi-autos, and This is definitely mixed. There are some revolvers that are pretty darn reliable, but revolvers also have a lot of moving pieces that can also fail and can also get dirt, grime, and grit in them, and once again, cause them to fail, cause them to bind, cause them to not work. Now, the easiest thing to say is that realistically, when you are going out into the wilderness, you should have a good holster for your handgun, and your gun should really never be getting dirty in the first place. Now, I've carried my 44 Magnum all over the place, and I've actually gotten that thing pretty dirty, and, you know, I've taken some spills before and ended up getting it muddy a little bit, but realistically, because it was in a good holster, the internal mechanisms, the cylinder, the actual, like, internals of the gun never got dirty because the holster was properly protecting the handgun. Now, you know, the handle might have gotten a little bit muddy, got some dirt and garbage, you know, kind of like right there on the handle, but ultimately the internals of the gun were protected because it had a good holster that protected it. And so what I will say is, when considering, you know, a outdoors gun, you know, you're not going to be just taking your gun, throwing it in the mud. You're not going to be taking it, throwing it in the sand. You're not going to be, you know, openly exposing your gun to problems that would cause it to fail. And moreover, you should have the gun properly secured in a way that it is not going to get, you know, foreign particulates in it. And so, to an extent, you do have to understand that all guns will fail, you know, any kind of extreme durability test. I will also say, this person said in their particular comment that it's an automatic, and I will say Glocks, especially Glock 20s, are used extensively in Alaska, and they are also automatics, or semi-automatics, truly, and they are very reliable handguns. So, slight side tangent, but ultimately, get a gun that, or all guns can fail, get a holster that will protect your gun, and ultimately be smart about your handgun. You know, don't let it get into environments or circumstances that would cause it to no longer work. And I understand accidents happen, but having had accidents happen to me before, like I said, making sure that your gun is adequately protected is really all that you need to do. Okay, so the next one is accuracy is not the greatest or isn't the greatest. So for this one, I would say that this is highly questionable and arguable. It sounds more like this person had a problem shooting the handgun. I will say Desert Eagles are not necessarily famed for their accuracy, but realistically speaking, a charging bear is not going to be at 100 meters or 100 yards. You know, you're not going to be shooting a charging bear, you know, way out. So accuracy for this handgun is more than adequate. My personal opinion, you know, having shot this handgun, having owned this handgun, the accuracy is certainly enough to stop a bear or get rounds on a bear or a moose or any type of predator, you know, within, I would say, 30 yards, you know, 30 yards and in. So as far as accuracy goes, you know, this gun might not be a match pistol, but it was never designed to be a match pistol. And realistically, when you're defending your life, you do not need a match pistol. So, okay, so the next one is they are too long. So referring to these guns as being too long. Now, this one really boggles my mind because once again, when you take a look at even stepping back to 44 Magnum revolvers, pretty much any realistic handgun at this range, you know, like that you're going to be using for wilderness self-defense, is likely going to have a 6-inch barrel, and if not longer. And so while I can see some credence here being given to the 10-inch barrel length Desert Eagles, I would not recommend those for wilderness defense. These 6-inch barrel or even 5-inch barrel Desert Eagles are more than adequate for, you know, draw times, you know, getting it out of the holster and shooting it. And ultimately, what I will say, because the long part of this kind of myth is that, you know, they're talking about, you know, the gun is too long, so by the time you draw it out, it'll be too late. For me, in my opinion, and granted, I've never had to shoot a charging bear or a charging animal yet, but for me, whenever I encounter an animal like a bear, like a moose, and I believe, in my opinion, that it poses an imminent danger to me, the gun is already out. Usually, I will grab the handgun in one hand, flip off the safety, and then I will have my bear spray or bear mace in the other hand ready to go. So for me, the gun is actually already out and ready to rumble. So in my opinion, this kind of myth of they are too long is really kind of facetious because, once again, like my 44 Magnum revolver has a 6-inch barrel, and just about any kind of super magnum that you want to carry has a 6-inch barrel. Now, I think where they're going with this is that you can get super short, you know, like the Super Red Hawk Alaskan from Ruger has a very short barrel, but you do want to be cautious whenever you go with barrel lengths too short that you do lose velocity, you do lose energy, you do lose a lot of what makes that bullet effective on target. And not only that, your recoil also goes up, so your follow-up shots suffer from that as well. So bear those two factors in mind. In my opinion, a 6 to 5-inch barrel Desert Eagle is just fine. And once again, if you're hoping to draw down on an animal, you're already in the wrong mindset. The moment you see an animal or a creature that poses an imminent threat to your life, that handgun should already be out of the holster. It should already be on target, waiting for the animal to charge. You should not be getting the gun into action when they charge. Okay, so the last one is the recoil is wicked. Now, this one, once again, is very subjective to your experiences. If all you've ever shot in life is 9mm, 5.56, you know, pretty lightweight rounds, then this gun is going to feel pretty bad. Like I was saying, if all you've ever shot is 9mm or reasonably lightweight kind of rounds, maybe even just 10mm, you know, this gun is going to feel pretty ferocious. But if you've spent any time shooting things like 44 Magnum or larger bore handguns, then this is going to feel pretty good. I mean, once again, this thing, having shot it, I noticed that it has more recoil than my 44 Magnum revolver, but I think the best way to put the recoil in this gun is that when I shot 7 rounds of 50 AE, it hurt my hand, or my hand hurt after shooting it. when I shot 6 rounds of Full House 44 Magnum, my whole hand went numb. So the best way to describe the recoil impulse of a 50 AE is that it feels like more recoil than a 44 Magnum, but it feels more like it's a push in your hand, whereas a 44 Magnum feels like it's punching your hand. So it feels like a lot more violent, kind of abrupt punch in your hand, whereas this gun feels like it's just pushing you more than it's punching you. And so once again, you know, after shooting 7 rounds, your hand will know it. Like, you're going to feel some pain in your palm. But at the same time, it didn't make my whole hand go numb. It didn't, you know, cause a really severe reaction. It's totally manageable, and I was able to, in one range session, easily shoot 20 rounds out of this gun. Now, like I said, after 20 rounds of 50 AE, your hand will hurt, but it's not going to be like, oh my goodness, I can't feel my hand. You know, I think the way that they present this is that the 50 AE's recoil is completely terrible, or the recoil impulse is terrible. But honestly, you know, once again, putting it up against its competitors of 44 Magnum, 454 Casull, it's right up there. I mean, whenever you're shooting a very potent handgun caliber, I mean, once again, this thing has, you know, anywhere from 1300 to 1500 foot-pounds of kinetic energy. You know, whenever you're shooting a bullet that is carrying that much energy, you're gonna feel it, you're gonna know about it. So that's what I will say about that. Now, granted, as you guys are also seeing, this is a Mark 19 with a integral compensator, so maybe the non-compensated 50 AEs kick a little bit more, and I would imagine they probably do. But at the same time, you know, having shot this compensated model, and this is my Desert Eagle, it's just fine. It, once again, is a lot of recoil, as you guys can probably see in the video. One of the kind of rounds that I was shooting, or one of the strings of shots I was shooting, you know, it kicked me enough where I had to readjust my footing. So this thing does have quite a bit of recoil, but it's not horrible by any means, and nor is it wicked, per se. So, anyways, guys, that is the 50 AE, and those are 5 myths that hopefully I broke down and busted when it came to the Desert Eagle. You know, this gun has a lot of myths and kind of memes to it. This gun is, you know, seen a lot in video games, and I feel like a lot of people look at the Desert Eagle and just think it's a joke because, you know, it's in so many video games. It's so, you know, kind of fantasized about, and it's not a real gun, but it definitely is a real gun, and it's a pretty effective real gun. So I will say I'm definitely a fan of it, and once again, it is one of my wilderness pistols for a reason, and I think it's a pretty good gun, and once again, it carries a lot of energy, but it carries a lot of energy, especially for a semi-automatic, so it is a good gun, but those are the myths, and hopefully you enjoyed this video. As always, guys, God bless, and I'm out.